The last time we stopped at chapter 2, verse 2, we talked about the three aspects of Kriya Yoga, and we said that these were self-study, Ishvara Pranidhana, which is opening up to the universal self or an expansion of consciousness. And of course, there's training of the senses and the mind. So these were the aspects that we talked about the last time, and we said that Kriya Yoga helps to attenuate the kleshas and helps us attain samadhi. So Sachin, I would request you to mute so that we don't have any background noise. Thank you. You can unmute yourself when you have a question, or you can use the chat. And so now we come to the various kleshas. There are five main kleshas, and kleshas are in fact nothing other than wrong form of cognition. In Sutra 1.7, we talked about the correct form of cognition, that is seeing things the way they are, seeing them the way they are in the correct way. This is correct cognition. But if you look at a sweet little dog and think that this is a monster, then that is incorrect cognition. Just because you have been bitten by a dog before does not mean that small little puppy is a little monster. It's just a sweet little puppy dog. And so we look at the world through our filter, and this filter we call them kleshas. They have colored the way we look at the world. So we don't see the world as it is, but we give it our own coloring. And these are called kleshas. There are five kleshas, and we list them in verse 2.3, and they are avidya, which is lack of awareness, asmita, which is self-identity, raga is attachment, dvesha is aversion, and abhinavesh is clinging on to life, or as some translated as fear of death. These are the five kleshas. So verse 3 merely mentions all the five kleshas. But now we continue and go deeper into each of them. So we go through each of them, understand how they're defined. We understand what it means. So don't be concerned about the Sanskrit words. We're going to try to understand these in a way that you can relate to them. So the first one in verse 2.4 is avidya. Avidya is the breeding ground for the others, whether they be dormant, attenuated, interrupted, or active. So the kleshas, depending on their activity or lack of activity, are now categorized. And there are four kinds. There's actually a fifth one, which we will come to later. But for us right now, we need to focus on these four. The most easy to understand is, of course, the active one. But let's start with dormant. For example, attachment to your child. Not all of you have children, but if you would, instead of a child, consider parent, you might also, or partner, that also works in the example. But attachment to child is a classic example. When you were young, you didn't have a child, so there was no attachment. But there was some sort of seed there in your mind, and that was dormant. So the attachment to your future child was dormant. Just realized that you were not looking at the document. So that's dormant. When this child started growing, became a teenager, the attachment decreased. This child was no longer small and cute and innocent, but became a difficult, independent-minded teenager. And so your attachment attenuated. And that's the next one. When this child maybe went away somewhere, or something happened to this child, the child came late home from school and you got worried, so your attachment got very active. You started getting very concerned. Maybe you even panic. So that is active. That's when that attachment to child klesha got really active. When the child is safe and in school, then the child klesha is there, but it is interrupted. It's not that active. So in this way, we can understand these four aspects of a klesha. You can use the example of a partner. Maybe when you were, of course, when you were young, you did not have a partner, you did not have a girlfriend or a boyfriend. There was nobody you were in love with because you were very small, you were innocent, and you were not even thinking along those lines. So that was dormant. Attachment to a partner or a person, the love interest was dormant. And it's the same procedure, whether it's your partner or it's a child. When the person is not there, for example, and you miss the person a lot, it's very active. And when the person is there, it's around you, you feel it's, the person is always there with you, it's interrupted. You don't feel it so intensely. And when perhaps your relationship with the person is not as good anymore, you can say it has attenuated. But it has attenuated in the respect of attachment. It may have now turned to aversion. Well, we'll come to that. So these are the four kinds of pleasures. These are the breeding ground. So everything springs out of this. All kleshas spring out of avidya. For that, of course, we have to understand what is avidya. But you can say that avidya is the mother of all kleshas. From avidya, all other kleshas, all other colorings spring out. So this is the breeding ground. Any questions about these four kinds of kleshas, this in terms of activity and dormancy? There are a couple of new people, so I'd like to say that you're, first of all, most welcome in the online meeting. You may also ask questions by unmuting yourself, or you can use the chat to ask questions. Everybody seems to be quite clear about this. Okay, in that case, we now come to the definition of avidya. So we have understood that avidya is the breeding ground, which means it's extremely important klesha that we should understand. So what exactly is avidya? It is translated as ignorance, but this is a very general word. So avidya has been defined very clearly in the Yoga Sutras as mistaking the transient to be eternal, the impure to be pure, pain to be happiness, and the non-self to be the self. For this, it would be really nice to go to our favorite diagram. Those of you who have been joining us know this diagram quite well, the others don't. But this is a very useful diagram. And so the first part was mistaking the transient to be eternal. Now, for all of you, transient means that which is not permanent, that which will die. So if you look at our diagram and you see what will die, the body and the senses, this is going to die. So put a little cross on it. The world outside is also going to die. So that's also gone. That's transient. When a person dies, the conscious mind dies as well. So the mind, conscious mind, is also gone. Naturally, the breath also goes. We know that when you die, one of the first signs is that you stop breathing. That's the way we know that a person is dead, apart from the heartbeats stopping. You know that when you cannot breathe anymore, you are in acute danger and you will die. So breath also is transient, so is conscious mind. Now we come to this part here, active and latent unconscious mind. Is this transient or is it permanent? It is called partially mortal self here. You see that up here, partially mortal self. So, what do you think? This is also transient. It's not permanent. As we expand our consciousness, this part also will become conscious and will die at one point of time. The only thing which remains permanently, which is eternal, is this part here. So eventually, also this and this will die. But one must remember that this is partially mortal, which means that when the body dies, the body and conscious mind dies. But this part here, this is the vehicle. So active and latent unconscious mind, together with the center of consciousness, is known as Jivatman. And that is reborn. So you're reborn again, and you can almost say that the body grows out of this. So a new body forms. You live your life, you die. Once again, this part falls away. And you have again the Jivatman. That is, this part together, this whole thing together, is reborn. So now some people think that the body is permanent, they begin to believe that this is permanent. It's a complete delusion that most people think. They get attached even to external objects. They get attached to their houses, to their cars, to their even to their clothes, and they hang on to all these things as if it were permanent. So this is the first aspect of avidya, that you think that all this part is permanent. Body, breath, mind. You think you're somehow you're going to live forever. Nobody wants to think about death. So for most times we behave as if we're going to live forever. So that is the first aspect of avidya, that we think that that which is transient is eternal. It's going to be permanent, it's going to live forever. So there's a question from Shibu. What is the difference between Jivatman and Atman? This is the Atman. The Atman is center of consciousness, here, right here. It's pure consciousness. It is pure prana, pure chaitanya, pure energy. And Jiva-Atman is this vehicle together. So the Atman is attached to this part of the mind. And the Atman is riding, so to say, in this vehicle. It is in this vehicle. It is in the active and unconscious mind. It's a treasure which is hidden there. And only when you unearth this treasure by removing these two layers of active and latent mind, does one see this beautiful treasure of Atman. So you see, Jeev Atman, this is the Jiva. This is the Jiva is including the dream state and deep sleep state. Both together is Jiva, and Jeev Atman is the combination of Jiva as well as Atman together. Okay. So we saw that was the transient is considered to be eternal. The next aspect is that we take the impure to be pure. So this is misunderstanding, that when things are mixed and it's not pure, it's not clean, then we can still consider it to be pure when it isn't. You just joined in. Namaste. I have muted you because of the background noise. If you would like to ask questions, you can use the chat, which you already have used. So there are two questions from Shibu once again. The center of consciousness is the center for all Jivatman, not only one individual. So, to come to this, this is the Jiva, sorry, this is the Atman here, and this is the Jiva, and this particular Atman here is connected to this particular Jiva. But where is this all playing out? Where is this all playing out here? This whole board, so to say, where is this all playing out? This entire paper, this white paper, what is that? That's all consciousness. That is universal consciousness. And that is where everyone is. So it's everybody is got universal consciousness. So when all this drops away, the latent, active, conscious, unconscious mind, both drop away, including the body, all that is left is center of consciousness. This center of consciousness is like a drop in the ocean. When the drop goes back to the ocean, there's no difference between the drop and the ocean. And so this here is the ocean, and you go back. And of course, in that case, you can say that this center of consciousness is also the center of consciousness of all individuals. And that's why we say that the Atman, or the pure consciousness, which is in you, is also in me. And it's in everybody. And therefore, we are all one, because that has the same quality. The drop goes back to the ocean. There's no difference between the ocean and the drop. It's the same. The quality is the same. And when you understand that, then you see that both you and I, Shibu, have the same consciousness. Okay? Another question from Sachin. Is all my past samskara seeded in my jivatman? Yes, exactly. All the action that you do here in this world, from conscious mind, body, senses, and the external world, is all stored here. In the active as well as in the latent unconscious mind. So these are your seeds here. And that comes back when you are reborn and forms a new body. We will be coming exactly to this shortly. We just need to understand what avidya is. And avidya has the next aspect. The third aspect is we think that pain is happiness. So we consider pain to be happiness. How is that possible that we consider pain to be happiness? Is it possible? Yeah, that is here. We think that pain is happiness because when we get attached to our child or to our partner, we are very happy that we have a child or we have a partner. And yet that very relationship causes us pain. Because when that child grows up, becomes a teenager and says something to you that hurts you, it makes you feel very, very hurt, and that's very painful. Or this partner who you love so much gets very sick. That's also very painful. Or the partner doesn't love you anymore and divorces you or leaves you. That's also very painful. And so we consider pain to be happiness. Things which will bring us pain, we consider them to be happiness. This is the third aspect of avidya. And the final and the most important aspect of avidya is that we consider that which is not the self to be the self. So this happens in two ways. And one is a way that you already know, I just explained it to you. You have begun to think that all this is permanent and you think this is it. The body is it. there's nothing more than the body, or there's nothing more than this world to get success, to get fame, to get wealth. Or you may think, this is the mind and that's it, there's nothing more to it. So you begin to think that the mind is it, the mind is the self. But the explanation of the Yoga Sutra goes much deeper. We know that in the mind, we also have one aspect known as buddhi, which is pure consciousness, similar to pure consciousness. It has a sattvic quality to it, but it is not pure sattva. It is not pure consciousness. And when we are in touch with this aspect of buddhi, then we start thinking that this is pure consciousness, when it is not. And so a lot of people have difficulties understanding what is the self. So they ask you, is it in the latent mind? It is buried deep inside the latent mind, but it is not in the latent mind in that sense. It's not part of the latent mind. It is not of the mind at all. It is beyond the mind. So this is the explanation of avidya. So we go to the next one, but before we go there, any questions on avidya, these four aspects of avidya? Shri Ram, what does pure mean in this concept, context? Pure and impure. That what is sacred is pure. That what is not mixed is pure. When we talk about mixed samskaras or karma or action, then we talk about things like purity in action, doing things that are right, the right action, that is purity. There are explanations which say the body is impure and we consider the body to be pure and with reference to the body. So purity is a concept that we all have to contemplate on us, by ourselves, and it could be an idea of how we approach the world. A relationship, for example, can be pure or impure. When in a relationship, you are expecting something, you're using the person, that becomes impure. So we need to understand what pure and impure means and learn to distinguish between the two. Okay. Before I go on to the next verse, which is verse 6, I would just like to say that a short announcement about our tradition, and that is our lineage is a meditative lineage, and therefore the way we teach the Yoga Sutras is from a perspective of practice. Normally, we say to understand the Yoga Sutras, you have to understand the mind. Don't study the Yoga Sutras, study the mind. In order to study the mind, you need to do meditation, dhyana, practice in a meditative tradition. For those of you who are really interested in getting systematic guidance, I'd be happy to help you. If you're genuinely interested, you can write to me, and do continue to come regularly and participate in the online meetings. This helps me to assess the student, the intensity of interest and the quality of the student, and accordingly we can proceed then. So if you're interested in learning systematic meditation and understanding yourself, your mind, and getting to know yourself, feel free to write to me. There is one more question here in the chat from Sachin. When Jivatman is pure consciousness, what separates this from Paramatman? Jivatman is not pure consciousness, Sachin. Jivatman is a combination of pure consciousness plus the mind. Together is Jivatman. So, and when we say mind, we're talking about the unconscious mind. To use modern technology, modern terminology, to use the words of the Indian tradition, we would say it is Atman plus dream state plus deep sleep state. So these three together is Jivatman. It's only when the mind drops away through meditation, through practice, is the soul free. So then the self is then free. Let me go back to our diagram. So now imagine that all this is gone here. Body is gone, conscious mind gone. Unconscious mind has been also dropped away. In the fire of knowledge, it has been burnt. There is no more mind. Now you are liberated. This is Kaivalya. This is pure consciousness here. So the individual consciousness, which is Atman, is now free and joins Paramatman. And when it joins Paramatman, that is called yoga. That is the union. The union between the individual self and the universal self. That is yoga. So when the individual self is free, nothing separates it from Paramatman or the universal self. So we go to the next verse, which is verse 2.6. And verse 2.6 is Asmita. This explains now what Asmita is. I have not put any translation there in brackets. Normally I put ignorance or attachment, aversion, but I have not put anything in brackets here because it's very difficult to translate in a simple word, English word. So, Asmita is defined as mixing the power of cognition with Purusha, the center of consciousness. So, before we go into the explanation, I want to clarify that Purusha, the center of consciousness, is the same thing as Atman. It's just another word. So, center of consciousness, which we saw on the extreme right-hand side in our diagram, the circle, and it's called center of consciousness. In Sankhya philosophy, it's called Purusha. In the Upanishads, it's called Atman. It's got many other names, Some people call it simply that. So it's also called pure consciousness. And this pure consciousness is different from buddhi. Buddhi is an aspect of the mind that's very close to pure consciousness. Very close. It's a very similar quality. Very sattvic. And because it is so similar, people get mixed. They begin to think that they have now become enlightened. Because when they come in touch with buddhi, then you hear this beautiful, clear voice of wisdom. And you think, this is it. This is pure consciousness. This is God. This is divine God talking to me. Because it has that quality. It has a very similar quality. There is a legend, which is also very much a part of this tradition. And that is the legend of the swan. The white swan, it is said, has the power to separate milk from water. You know, when you mix milk and water, you dilute the milk basically, you mix milk and water together, it's not possible to separate the two. But the legendary swan has such a sharp buddhi that it can separate the two. It can tell the difference between the buddhi and pure consciousness. So such a sharp mind one must have to be able to distinguish between these two. In the process of internal dialogue, when you have been practicing, if you know it, you will begin to come in touch with buddhi. Initially, you will have a lot of manas chattering, ahankara chattering. You will have all sorts of memories bubbling up from chitta. But finally, you will hear this beautiful, gentle voice of buddhi. And if you listen to it and follow it, it will guide you in all aspects of your life. Having heard that, many practitioners think they have now come into touch with the pure consciousness, but they haven't. They are still in the domain of the mind. Buddhi is in the mind. It's somewhere here in the mind. And we hear it in internal dialogue. We begin to come in touch with it. But that is not buddhi, which is pure consciousness. Buddhi is part of the mind. Pure consciousness is here, right at this end. So to understand the difference between buddhi and pure consciousness, there has to be a disunion. You need to be established here and look at the world from this point of view. And then you see, aha, buddhi is somewhere here or here somewhere. When that happens, only then do you understand what is asmita. You were so caught up in it, in this identification, that you do not know what it is. And this is one of the most difficult things to explain because you do not have that experience. And when you have the experience, it's relatively easy to understand. But until you've had that experience, it becomes a little bit of an intellectual process. So this is asmita. Any questions about asmita? Okay, there seem to be no questions on Asmita. What is this? Sriram writes, so is this one of the last kleshas to be cleared? Yes, indeed. Good question here. In fact, the order in which you would go is, normally you need to deal with Abhinavesh first, fear, then attachment and aversion, then comes Asmita, and finally the very root of the problem, and that is avidya. So you have to go from the more superficial to the deeper. We will understand shortly why Abhinavesh or the fear of death is in fact more superficial compared to the others. Okay, then we come to attachment, verse 2.7. Attachment or raga is that which follows remembrance of pleasure. This should be relatively easy for most of us to understand, because we all know what attachment is. We've all experienced it. Attachment you experience, for example, when a desire has been fulfilled. It could be something as simple as eating sweet or chocolate or ice cream, and you say, this is really delicious, I want more. And there it goes. That is kind of attachment. You experience something after eating that ice cream or the chocolate, which is pleasurable. And when it is pleasurable, you want to have more of it. We can take the example of your relationship with a partner or your child or even a parent. And you see that when you are with this person, you're spending time, you're in a relationship with this person, you're enjoying that, you want more of it. You feel satisfied. And that certain impression that is created is pleasurable, and so we want more, and that's causing attachment. We can be attached even to objects, just like I talked right now about relationships with people. You can also get attached to objects. So you can be very attached to your car or to your house. We can even be very attached to our mobile phones. Right? We all know that. It's a very big attachment. Then the latest version of the iPhone comes out and everybody wants that. So we want more of these things. And not only do we get attached to people and worldly objects, we also get attached to certain ideas or experiences. So, for example, fame, success, wealth, prosperity, these are ideas that we all like. We want to have that. So, this is also very attractive for us. And when there's attraction, we want more, that is attachment. There are basically three kinds of attachments. They're called Ishanas. The first one is Putra Ishana, which is attachment in relationships. Essentially, it is referring to your attachment to your child, but it also covers your attachment to partners, to your parents, to all close relationships. Second is called Vita Ishna, that is your attachment to possessions and wealth, comforts, things like cars, houses, etc. And then there is Lokaishna. Lokaishna is fame and success. When somebody renounces, takes sannyasa, that is, he does tyaga, he is renouncing these in the sense of externally. He may still be mentally attached to these ideas, but he has renounced these in the physical sense. So such a person takes a vow that he will not have children, he will not be in a relationship, he will not get married. This is the first Ishna that he has to renounce. So a renunciate also has to renounce all wealth, possessions. He will not have car, he will not have house, he will not have all these things, comforts. And he will renounce also fame and success. That is Lokrishna. So that is Tyaga. While we are all householders here, we do not have to renounce these externally. You can continue to enjoy these objects in the physical world, but you do not have to get attached to them. I sometimes use this example of a flat or an apartment that you may have rented. It doesn't belong to you, but you're renting it, so you're living in it, you're enjoying it. You're making the most of that apartment, right? I think that's a very clear idea, everybody understands. So if you would use all these objects, you would enjoy them, being aware that this is not mine, that would be considered to be renunciation. Internal renunciation is called vairagya. So for those of you who want to be on this path, who want to do systematic meditation, it's important to understand that you do not have to necessarily give up the objects of attachment, but you need to internally acquire a attitude which is that of enjoying the object but not getting a sense of ownership. You don't own it, you just enjoy it. You don't own your partner, you don't own your child, but you can enjoy the time that you have on this plane, the limited time you have, you can enjoy this relationship. Similarly with all objects which are like houses, cars, everything. Enjoy these, use them, they're useful, but do not get the sense of ownership. So it's important to know the difference between external and internal renunciation. Very often, those who are on this path, they misunderstand this idea of detachment. They think detachment means I should not enjoy these things anymore. I will not talk to my partner anymore. I'm going to keep aloof from my child. This is disastrous because children need love and attention. But to act cold, this is a misinterpretation of scriptures. A misunderstanding. The idea of spirituality and detachment is not cold and loveless. In fact, it is the expansion of our circle of love. Perhaps some of you know this idea that we must first learn to look after ourselves, not in an egotistical sense, but learning to be gentle to ourselves, taking care of our body, our diet, looking after ourselves in the sense of having healthy habits, regular habits, being disciplined. Then, after we are able to look after ourselves, Our responsibility expands to our family. We include our family, we take care of them, we take care of each other. When you're able to do that, you expand your circle of love even further to those at work, your employer, your employees, your colleagues. You embrace them in this larger circle of love. When you are strong enough and you can have a greater awareness, greater sense of responsibility, even to your relatives and friends. Be there for each other. When you're a very strong person, you're not getting attached, you're not falling into this attachment every time, getting disturbed, getting upset, suffering, and you are able to be above it, then you can expand your circle of love to include your neighborhood, your community, the society, and even country. And eventually, whole of humanity. When you have expanded so completely, you will find that suddenly you are no longer attached to any of these things. You are suddenly established in the self because you have expanded your consciousness so much that you are now established here. And so, by expansion of our awareness and our sense of responsibility, we can also attain the highest. So we see in this way how we can go to the highest even through just this path of decreasing our attachments. It's one of the most important kleshas. Working with attachment can lead us to the very highest. So, expansion of awareness does not mean shifting awareness. So if I say, yes, expand your awareness to your family, it doesn't mean you don't look after yourself and only take care of your family. Expanding awareness to your friends and relatives or work doesn't mean you only work all the time and you forget about your family. Or you only hang out with your friends and ignore your family. That's not expansion of awareness. That's shifting your awareness from family to friends or from family to work. So we are not talking about shifting awareness. We are talking about expanding awareness. I hope you understand the difference. Shifting awareness means you remain contracted in your consciousness, in your awareness. You have only shifted it from one thing to the other. So instead of it being family, now it's work. And you become a workaholic and you think you've expanded your consciousness. You haven't. Or you start doing things for your community, but you completely ignore your family. That doesn't sound right, does it? So that is not expansion of consciousness. That's shifting consciousness. So questions on this klesha. Question is there a test to know for yourself if you are attached to something? Is it easy to delude yourself that you're not attached while you are? It's very easy to delude yourself. You will find out how attached you are when life will test you. So you may think you're not attached to your partner, and then when your partner gets sick, you will find out how attached you are. You think you're not attached to your child, when your child is suddenly a teenager, Then you will realize how painful it is when the teenagers are saying things which are not very nice, or when the child comes home late, disappears, I don't know, because they're off playing somewhere or partying somewhere and forgot to tell you. Then you will realize what attachment means. So this delusion that you are above certain relationships is very common among those of us who are on this path, because very often we overestimate ourselves. It's very common. So the whole path is always a process of continuous expansion. Any more questions on this?
Radhika, I did not understand this shifting consciousness.
Mm-hmm. Yes. We talked about expanding consciousness. And I said that this is in the scriptures. The first responsibility is to yourself, that you take care of yourself. And it doesn't mean being egotistical or selfish. It means you're just taking care of yourself. If you're not able to look after yourself, you cannot look after your family. I think that's clear, right? If you're a very sick person, for example, you're physically sick, mentally sick, how shall you look after your family? It's very difficult. So first thing, you look after yourself. If you are stable, you're balanced, you can look after yourself. But now, assuming that you're healthy, stable, balanced, you take on responsibilities of your family and you say, I will look after my partner and my children. So you have expanded. For all of you who are married or who have a relationship, you know that when you first come together and live together, there's always a clash of egos. And it's not easy in the first couple of years to live with another person. And you need to expand. You need to stop thinking about yourself. And you need to expand your consciousness to include this other person in your life. Then when children come, they have some other ideas. And for them, you also have to be very selfless. You have to learn to put aside some of your ideas and you expand. But when you make certain sacrifices for your family, you should not forget yourself. Taking care of your children, especially when they're very little, no? When they're very small, when they're infants, then one tends to give them a lot of love and attention, and that can become very, very difficult, especially for the mother. That time is very exhausting. So would this young mother be able to take care of her child if she gets so exhausted that she falls sick? No. So what I'm trying to say is, you do not forget yourself. You learn to take care of yourself as well, and then include your family in it. Don't just shift from myself now to my child. Same thing is for those people who like to do welfare activities, who like to volunteer, do things selflessly in society. You may be a part of some group, you may be volunteering for something, you're a part of some sort of a non-profit organization, and you spend a lot of time there. But you should not do it by simply shifting your awareness or consciousness and ignoring the family or ignoring your needs, your basic needs. You have to look after yourself. That's why we say that those who work a lot, this happens very often, that you just shift your consciousness or awareness to work and you forget about family, you forget about yourself. You don't take care of yourself at all. Right? So this is a Very important aspect to understand. Expansion does not mean just shifting your awareness. It means expanding. It includes all the previous aspects and more. It requires one to be a very strong person, to have not attachments, but learn to see things in a very detached manner. So it requires for you to work with this particular klesha and attenuate it. Only when you have attenuated this klesha can you expand your consciousness. Okay? So we are at the end of our hour and we will stop here. We continue next Friday, same time. And to those of you who are interested in getting in touch with me, you can write to me either on Facebook, a private message, or you can write me an email from the website. The email is yoga@that-first.com, or you can just fill in the form. Okay? So, thank you very much, everybody, for being here. See you next time. Bye-bye. Namaste. Bye-bye, Perry. Nice to have you. Bye, Debbie. Bye, Shanta. Bye, everyone. Bye. Bye-bye, Books.